Okay, good afternoon everybody. I hope you had a good lunch. Soon after I first started getting involved in research, I chanced on a book. It was called Researching Lived Experience, Human Science for an Action-Sensitive Pedagogy by Max von Marmon. From his phenomenological approach to pedagogy, with its emphasis on experience and relationship, I recognized words that spoke directly to me as a teacher of Dalhousie Lived. It's therefore my greatest pleasure, on behalf of the conference, to welcome Max von Marmon, Professor Emeritus at the University of Alberta and Adjunct Professor at the University of Victoria.
Thank you. short video, what's wrong with this? Okay. So, you know, read every one of these moments. They're all things not trivial. So every day, so normal. But each one of these moments, and I'll show you some examples later, can be a phenomenological stuff. Every one of these 2 seconds moments can be a whole book, can be a dissertation for Thomas Lewis. It's really quite remarkable. So, so in a way, I think my whole presentation will be kind of an exploration of the notion of moment, what a moment is. And in one sense, you can say a living moment is an instant of the now, isn't it? And phenomenology tries to study exactly that. What is the meaning of these moments, instances of the now? Now the first thing, you see, I've seen this quite a few times, this movie in workshops. And it's only now, because of this conference, I've become so aware of movement, that I'm realizing that every one of the little incidents is a movement. Did you notice that? Mm-hmm. You probably know as little as that you feel that your specialty, that's your expertise. And movements, phenomenologically, can be seen as to get a significance from certain sources. And these are three obvious sources, and there are more. One is the landscape. If you go back over these incidents, you will see that so many of them are immediately recognizable. Because these are the things people do. And you instantly know what people are doing. Right? In their action, in their hands, the way they're walking, what they're making. You know, that's what they're doing. But there's also other movements. And these are movements that issue from the inner self. These movements are puzzling. You don't quite know what is going on. In fact, they seem to reveal something mysterious, maybe secret, maybe hidden about the person. And if you think back of the presentation that Ruth did with all these volunteers on the stage, I thought there were some really nice moments there where some of these volunteers, when they were doing postures, you know, and always different. And every now and then, people started spontaneously to applaud, to clap their hands, because it was so nice, so striking. And yet, I would say, you didn't really quite know what the meaning is of the process, but the issue from the person, from the inner life of the person. So that's another way that movements can be understood. And then, of course, the other is a very common one, is that our movements are modified by the glance of the other. If you look at me approvingly, I'll do better. And if you look at me critically, right, then you become uncertain. So an approving look strengthens your subjectivity. Critical looks take your subjectivity away. They make it into an object. And women often complain that's how men, or some men look at it. They objectify it, right? Look at look. This is actually just an aside, but it struck me in this video that is going on. So, you can say that each of these moments, the living moments, are moments of the now. And what is it about the now? Well, this is really interesting, I think. This should work. Guys, okay, so the idea of the now.
Well, isn't it so that we're all in the now? Right? How can you not be in the now?
That's why you're laughing. I thought it was just a wonderful line. But, you know, how can you not be in the now? Right? And yet, there's something strange about it. Because even though I'm in the now, and I'm right now talking with you, and I had this microphone, a little incident. Yet, when I try to grasp that moment, it's always too late. You can never grasp it in the now. So it's sort of a strange thing. You're always in the now, and yet you're never in the now. Do you see? That's a phenomenological predicament that also makes it phenomenologically interesting. That in order to capture a moment, the living moment, you see,
you in fact have to retrospect the meaning of the moment. You cannot introspect it, right? And that is sort of an important phenomenological observation. Now these, can I just quickly ask you, how many of you have heard about Heidegger? Oh, many, okay, good. How many have not heard about Heidegger? Oh, there are some, yeah? All right, well, when we talk about phenomenology, there are two outstanding science phenomenologists, philosophers, right, really. And that is Husserl on the left, he was kind of the instigator and the founder of phenomenology, and Heidegger. Heidegger was a student of Husserl. And Heidegger, later in life, when he started to talk about how he got to phenomenology, he said, well, Husserl's teaching took the form of practicing phenomenological seeing. You know, and by that he means to see the meaning of something, to see the meaning of a living moment. That's really what it is. You know? And so,
can you still hear me?
Yeah, please. So, what I'd like to do here, for the sake of, you know, getting a little bit sort of the common things about phenomenology, to give some examples. Okay? And so, I'm giving you four or five examples of phenomenological seeing, if you like. This one is the lecture. It's sort of a boring example, but it's one of the early ones that Heidegger himself gives. He only spends half a page in one of his books on it, but it is kind of interesting nevertheless. Because then he asks, you know, obviously he wants to say something to his students about seeing meaning. And so he is sort of thinking to him, well, I can use an example, the lecture. And he asks them, what do you see when you walk into the room and you see the lecture? Well, you have to also see it. You know, this is about 50, 70 years ago, right, in Germany. Much more pompous. You know, the professorship and the university and so on. The lecture was quite something. Would you come here and stand just behind it? No, rather not, right? There's something about the lecture that also, you know, you're making a claim when you stand behind it. You might not be able to stand behind it, frankly, right? And so, I said, what do you see when you come to the room? Well, the students would say, well, the bright ones, the psychologists would say, well, you know, you see impressions, and your brain translates it into what it is, a lecture. Others would say, well, it's just two boxes on top of each other, that's what you see. Again, others would say, yeah, yeah, you see that, but it's also wrapped in varnish. And Heidegger said, when you look at the lecture, you immediately see meaning. You know, you don't see the boxes. You don't see. In fact, he says, when I walk into the room, I'm even annoyed because someone left a book on it. Right? And I'm annoyed. And I see my annoyance, you can say. And so, I would say, what you see in the lecture is immediately the sense of, well, that's where the talk will happen. That's the connection between the professor and the students. The lecture is the university, in a way, isn't it?
Microphone.
Talking into this.
The lecture is the university. It is your education, right?
And so in that sense, it is full of meaning. In some sense, you can say, when you see the lecture, you see the whole world. You see the whole academic world. You know, that's part.
And that's a really important aspect of Heidegger's teaching. You know, Husserl, who you can faintly see behind, also had interesting observations about intentionality.
That, you know, whenever you see it, you always are attached to the world in a certain way, and so that's what you see, the way that you are attached. But also, he talks about adumbrations. What is adumbrations? Well, Husserl would say, it's interesting, empirically, you never see the whole lecture, do you? You only ever see it from one side. You can see it from this side, from that side, but never the whole thing at once. There's always some uncertainty. Is it still like this, or, right? And so you can walk around it, and usually we say, you always see adumbrations. But phenomenologically, you see the whole lecture. Right? Phenomenologically, you don't see adumbrations. You see the lecture and such. And so that is everything about that. You know, I looked and looked and looked and tried to find pictures of Heidegger and Husserl behind the lecture. Husserl apparently never stood behind the lecture, he always stood in front of it. And he was a very boring professor, but fascinating. I think of this guy, but I can't find a picture, but I can't, could find a picture of this guy. But is there still the same nature? Right? Is there still thoughtfulness, knowledge? No, it's wrong. Now I'm going to give you some quick examples. Of phenomenological seeing. And I'm really interested in this notion of phenomenological insights. Because phenomenology, you know, they may be seen as a qualitative research method, right? And the point of the method is to come up with insights, really, about the meaning of things. But that's really difficult. But nowadays, everywhere you go, everywhere you look, people promise schemes, technologies, you know, software packages, so that all you have to do as a doctoral student is follow the steps. Step one, do this. Step two, step five. Now you've got your study done. Well, it doesn't work with phenomenology like that. It's much more complicated and it's, in a sense, much more depending on what you yourself make of it. So this is another example, actually not so different from Heidegger. And there's this bottle of wine. Vandenberg, I use him a lot in the teaching. He's a psychiatrist, he just died recently. Very famous, wrote many, many books, some translated into English and other languages. And he tells a little story about a friend who was going to come and visit him in the evening in his Dutch town. But the friend phoned and said, "Look, you know, it's snowing like hell. I don't think I can get my car out of here. I just have to cancel. Maybe another night." And Vandenberg says, okay. Vandenberg takes a book, starts to read. And then half an hour later, he looks up from his book. And then he asks, "What do you see?" And this is a quote, a short piece from his book, and it's really kind of interesting. He says, and here, like, I'll read with you, because these are kind of nice little passages. He says, "I look up from my book, I'm reading, and I see the bottle of wine, and I realize that my friend will not come. What happens at this moment, or more precisely, what do I see when I observe the bottle of wine? The question seems trivial. And the answer is accordingly simple. I see a green bottle with a white label on which is printed a mark. At closer examination, I can read the printed words. It is the bottle of Medoc. The bottle is corked and sealed with a lead capsule. But it becomes obvious to me that writing down these facts about seeing, I don't really get any nearer to that which I was observing when looking up." He says, "I saw the bottle. But what I was seeing then was not a green bottle with a white label with the capsule and things like that. What I was really seeing was something like the disappointment that my friend would not come. And what I was really seeing was my loneliness." Isn't that right? Do you see what you're saying here? So it is not the white label on the bottom that you notice when you look up from your book. You look at the bottle and you see, oh, God. Right? You're going to be alone. You're going to be on your own. That is phenomenology. You look at the experiential, at the lived experience of that lived moment, right? Rather than the so-called objective facts. I will give another example. It was quite nice. And this is Vandenberg. He has some of these very nice phrases. I think this is really a nice one. "The phenomenologist should not direct his glance inwardly, like look inside what you're thinking and feeling, but outwardly, expressed paradoxically. We are seeing ourselves when we observe the world." You see yourself when you look at the world. But you are out there, you're not in here. Right? That's again the phenomenological. And people really quite often don't get that. They think phenomenology means introspection, looking inside yourself all the time. The next one is, remember, this is the same Vandenberg. He always starts with a little story. This is really interesting. He takes quite a few pages to describe this. And he says, what happens when you remember something, a remembrance? And he gives the example of Cocteau, a French philosopher, writer. And Cocteau lives in Paris, and he grew up in Paris. And he went to the district, the area where he used to live as a child. He had done it before, walked through the streets, looked at the school, and so on. And, you know, but never really, it wasn't really very helpful, you know, to think of his childhood, right? So he did it one more time. He went to the house where he used to live, and he walked to the door, he walked to the back, and then someone shouted, "Hey, what are you doing there?" So he quickly walked away, right? And he was disappointed. It looked like my childhood is gone. There's nothing here that I remember. And as he walked away, he did what some of us do. He walked because in Paris, all the houses are right up to the street. Sometimes in front of the house, you have a little gate, metal gate. Right? And as he was walking, his fingers, his hand trailed the walls of the house and the gate. And wow, weird. Memories came back. He started to remember things. Started to remember how he walked. He started to remember that, yeah, when he was walking, he would always make sure, as a child, that he touched all the trees. As a child, he did that, right? You get sentimental about it. You don't want to leave any of the trees out and disappointed. So you must touch them all on the way to school. And then he realized it was still not quite right. And then he said, so what I did, I walked, I realized that when I was young, I was going like this, I was smaller. So he walked like this with his hand along the walls and so on. And yes, the teacher's names came back. The school came back, the neighbor, his father's beard, everything, all these memories came back. Now, Vandenberg's point is, his insight, his phenomenological insight is, the memories are in the things. I hope the doctor is not here to problem. They're not in your brain. Well, of course, in some sense, they're in your brain. But you couldn't get them out of your brain. You need the gate, you need the street, you need the wall, you need to let your hands go. And he says, my fingers, like the needle of the old-fashioned phonograph, what do you call it, gramophone, right, was picking up my memories the way the needle is picking up the music. And, well, that's the phenomenology of it. That's how it is with memories. That's how you get them back. There's no point sitting down and trying to reach back into your consciousness or your memory or the synapses or the neurons or whatever. It won't come. And so Vandenberg spends quite a bit of time, because then he says psychologists will say, oh, that's nonsense, and you know, neuroscientists will say that's all nonsense, memories of your brain. And he argues that at the end, it's hard not to agree with him, because yes, phenomenologically, experientially, that's how life is, that's how it's put together. Oh, well, here are some of those passages, but I won't get into that. But it's really quite interesting. Oh yeah, and this, I couldn't help because, you know, when I read that example of his, I thought, yeah, darn, when I was a kid, when I walked to school, did that. And this is, I could only find this. This is a picture of the street where I lived, except that's 1905. And when I went to school, it was in the 50s, right? And so, but do you see the gates with the spikes? And in Europe, you have that a lot. Often there's no room for any gardens. But, you know, in front of the house is a little bit of that. So that, you know, and here, just a couple of days ago, Judith and I walked in downtown, the downtown area. And you see everywhere, you have these European type gates. And I wonder if kids here do the same thing. You know, walk along and trail your fingers on the spikes. So, and the next topic, one true product, I think, is eye contact. Now, that's a really nice one. It's a wonderful topic. It has so much richness. There's books written on this. Many phenomenologists have done interesting examinations of this. That's, you remember, that's the very first picture from the video that you saw. You know, when babies are born. And this is just a newborn. They start to open. And in the beginning, the eyes sort of wander all over. Then soon, they start to fix on things. And if you hold the baby in your arms, you'll notice that, you know, and they fix on you. But it only fixes. There's not yet really contact. But then, almost every parent knows this. After a short while, suddenly, the baby looks at you. Almost in the same way as it did when it was just, the eyes were just hitting your face. But now you know, you're being seen. And you see, it's a funny thing, it's very hard. How would you even describe it? It's very difficult to describe that moment where the baby looks at you and there's eye contact. And the mother or the father says, hey, he's looking at me. And funny, often at the same time, there's a smile. The first smile of the child. Right? And the phenomenologist Burton has written a very nice article about that. And he says, the first smile is when this infant, when this little child starts to open itself to you. It's opening yourself up to the world. That's what smiling does, opening yourself. Whereas, you know, grimacing is close to yourself, right? And when, you know, where I live, I like bicycling, often I bicycle. And then when the sun hits my face, I cannot help but smile, I guess. And all these wonderful women smile back. And they're really smiling. But, you know, all I'm saying, what happens in a smile is you open yourself. And other people open themselves back. That's what smiling does. It's a wonderful thing. As long as it's genuine. Because some politicians smile, but they're not genuine smiles. And so, here, this is a wonderful, this picture grips me because I know about this baby. This baby is under the care of my son. My son is a neonatologist. He looks after newborns who have serious problems, or who are born prematurely. And this one, this child, will most likely die. But look at the eyes. Oh, it's looking at the mother. It's just astonishing. It's an incredible. It haunts me. You know, I keep thinking of this, picture. And that's my son. And I see you. And he is so interested in the subjectivity of his children. You know, he says, we start studying infants when they're older, right? But we don't know anything about babies who are just born. But in the womb, we know there's empirical research that in the womb, children already hearing their mother's voice. When they're born, they recognize the voice. The same with music, they will recognize the music. You know how the children even can cry in the womb? And so Michael says, so what's going on? Can we actually say that the child has an experience? Is there already a sense of self? Is there already a sense of consciousness? He's writing a book on that right now. And he's already published some interesting articles on it. And so this whole idea of eye contact is really important. And so these are three quotes, just three quotes of the literature that I really like. One is Levinas, and Levinas says, you know, when you make contact with another person, what do you see when you look at the other person? You look the person in the face. Well, if you're struck by the other person, and you say, you think to yourself, oh, what a big nose, right? Or he really made up. Or he should really, you know, look after his teeth, or whatever. And Levinas says, when you look at the exteriors of the other, you don't really see the other. What you're really doing, you're seeing yourself. You're seeing yourself making sense of the other. Really, much of seeing, almost all our seeing of the world is taking possession of the world, isn't it? It's possessing the world. That's what you do when you're seeing. But Levinas says, there's also moments when it doesn't happen. When you look at the other person, and especially if the other person is ill or fragile or something has happened, and you say, oh, gee, let me help you. In that moment, you look at the other person in the face, and you don't see the exteriors. You only see the otherness of the other. You see the other person's invisibility, you might say, the soul, you know, the mystery of the person. I think good teachers keep seeing it in their children, rather than always seeing the troublemaker and the this and the that and whatever, right? But you see the human being who has this, you know, who has this. And then the second quote by Alfonso Lingus is wonderful as well, because Lingus actually turns around and he says, yes, but when you look someone in the face and the face is hard, you can see the suffering, you can see. And then he says, to face another is to touch with the eyes. It is to sorrow our eyes with the sweat and the grime and the toxins and the microbes. The suffering of the other is felt in our eyes. We feel it. That's another phenomenological way of, and I think that's also part of the experience. The phenomenology shows that life is complex, and many dimensions with this. And then Jean-Luc Marion. Now this one I really love. When I was reading this not too long ago, I thought, and since then I can't help but constantly look at other people in this sort of way. Because Marion says, what do you do when you look at the other person? And he's a bit like Levinas. He says, well, you know, don't look at the externals, don't look at the lips and the eyes and the color of the eyes and all that sort of stuff.
just read it. And he says, what do we look at in the face of the other person? Not his or her mouth, but the eyes. Or more exactly, this, I just love this sentence. Or more exactly, the empty pupils of the person's eyes. They're black hollow. It's a bit odd the way he says it. But do you get it? That your pupils is the one place in your eye where there's nothing. Because the pupil is really a hole, right? It's an opening. There's nothing there. The iris, yeah, of course, there's the iris in this color. But the pupil is nothing. But where do we look when we look the other person in the eye or in the face? In the pupil. Without the pupil, it would be really odd to look at a person. And it's really hard too, because see, I can look at you all the way over there. And even though, you know, I can see you, if you didn't have pupils, it would be an odd experience for me. Right? So I find this really quite fascinating. In other words, in the face, we fix on the sole place that precisely nothing can be seen. Oh, I'm not that difficult. This is enough. That's the relation to the other. We see precisely the point at which all visible spectacle happens to be impossible, where there's nothing to see. So this is what he says. This conceptual moment, we talk about moments, little moments, and he says, I see the other where nothing can be seen. Exactly that place of your eye where there's nothing to see. It's just a black hollow.
Micro.
Black hollow. Do you get that? Don't you think this is an incredible insight? I really think this is just unbelievable. You know, none of the other philosophers have noticed that. And you may say, well, of course. But could you have said that? You know, and so I wonder what happened. You know, how did Marion, he's a very famous philosopher, French philosopher, some people think he is as famous now as Heidegger was in the past. And I sort of wonder what happened. And I think it may have been that he was sitting at the dining room table, talking to the kids, you know, he has some children in his life. And maybe just in that moment that he was looking at one of his kids, all of a sudden, he realized. And he went, and quickly ran to his office to write it out. Or something like that. You know, it could have been like that, right? Or maybe he was discovering that he was writing something else. Anyway, I find it really interesting. But do you see what I'm saying? Without pupils? It becomes really bizarre. Oh. Well, this one, you all know, famous really image. But here again, we can see, you know, at this, you are looking into the unfathomable soul of these eyes. Don't you? You know this picture. And again, just look. Where do you look? And this picture is really interesting because the woman is so striking, so beautiful in the red and so on. So you're inclined to look at the picture of it. But even though you're inclined to do that, the eyes correct you. The eyes look at you. They look at your eyes, right? And you see some the black pupils of the eyes, you might say. So, okay, this is a very quick final example of the other times. I always have problems. Okay, so this is the one we also saw. You remember this scene?
Fellow running to the bus.
And this is interesting as well, because, you know, here is Sartre. He wrote a whole book basically on that idea. That when you run to the bus and then you go home, you say to your wife or your husband, yeah, I ran for the bus, it didn't stop. And the settler asked, what bus? What did you experience? Was there an eye that you experienced? No, there wasn't. When you ran for the bus, there was no eye. You add that later. So later you objectify. This is sort of an example, what I said earlier about the now. That, you know, when you try to capture the now, you're almost too late. And so, and yet, at the same time, What you are capturing eventually, you know, the moment, was maybe never quite there in that sense, because there was no eye. Sartre would say, in the moment of running, there was just running for the bus. That's the experience.
That's not I, that's not objectification. None of that.
Okay, so these are some of the phenomenological insights that I just showed you. Right? And then this. Where do these insights come from? That's really my interest. That's what I'm working on in my own work, writing. And I'm saying, and I ask whether you have these experiences, that when you suddenly see something, you are struck by something, by an insight of some sort. And now I'm quickly going to talk about this, the idea of no method, because I really don't think there's a method to this, but maybe a no method. I don't want to skip things, and yet at the same time, this is not so important. But as Ananda, he was Buddha's helper, and he knew all the method of meditation. But when Buddha died, he was supposed to enter the circle of initiates and the council. But he had never had an enlightenment himself. Isn't that weird? Here he was the method master for Buddha, and yet he had never been enlightened. So he sat for days and days in order to try to get enlightened. Nothing happened. And eventually he thought, oh, this is just unbelievable. You know what to do. So he said, I'm too tired. I've done this for 3 days, and you know, without sleeping, I have to sleep. So he started to lie down, and the moment he started to lie down, see, there's a movement. The moment he started to lie down, he got, there is no method. There is no method to insight. It is a no method method. That became his enlightenment. That became his, you know, his, you know, one of my former students is a Buddhist, a full-fledged Buddhist, and he told me this story. And then there's Kairos and Kronos. Have you heard of Kairos and Kronos? Well, sure you've heard of Kronos. Kronos is time, clock time, right? But Kairos, you don't know really probably much about. Kairos was the grandson of Kronos. Kronos is an old guy with a beard. And he keeps time, absolute time, clock time. You know, so this is time that you can count on, it's predictable, controllable, manipulable, and so on. The time that you, you know, check and so on, you go to the office, you work within this kind of time. Kairos is a really weird figure. I have several books on Greek mythology. None of them say anything about Kairos. It's only in recent times that people are rediscovering this Kairos. Because scientists and philosophers are saying, Kairos is saying something important about our human condition. You know? And Kairos is really the god also of time, but quality of time. So, Kairos is the god of the fleeting moment. Kairos, he is rebellious, he is whimsical, creative, he is improvisational. He belongs here, in this room, right? Rather than procedural, as Kronos. Kairos is depicted with what we might now call a Gothic Kairos, you see? He also has double wings, so that he can read, that sort of shows that when he goes, he reads a lot of speed, he goes fast. So indicating that Kairos, in each moment is fleeting, evanescent, propitious, serendipitous. Kairos time is the moment of the living now, the instant of the living now. In such Kairos moment, time seems to stand still, where time is time. And I think that often happens when we're dancing. When you're dancing, that's the one time in our lives that I have a feeling, and some philosophers have talked about that, that time seems to no longer be there. It seems to stand still. It's like clocks without time, right? And here is, so Kairos time, just read it for yourself. Kairos time ruptures Kronos time. It's the perfect moment of the now. Kairos is the pure now. Kairos demands of us the right thing at the right time. Only the right action can at the right time will do. If you hesitate, then you're too late. This is sort of a nice little close-up, because this is very important about Kairos. When Kairos comes by, and you have a chance to make a decision on something, you better do it right at that moment. And so what the whole idea of Kairos is, that you have to grab his hair. But the hair is on the front. So if you hesitate and you grab, your hand will slide off the back of the skull, you see? And then all you can have is regret that you missed it. You missed the insight. You missed the opportunity to make $1 million, whatever it is. Right? That's the Kairos moment, you can say. Oh. And this is Kairos, and metanoia. Metanoia is another God, the God of regret. She often is behind him. So if you failed to take the moment, then metanoia may either console you, or maybe she will be sorry. Not very nice. Okay, so now the question for me is that how do these moments come? These insights that we have sort of received. Now this is interesting. Well, you have to go to Albert Einstein, right, to ask the question of insights. And this is often said on the web that Einstein said about the really special theory of relativity. Oh, I was riding my bike, that's how I got it. Well, do you really think so? Maybe, but not like that. But here he is just fooling around. Maybe if he was riding his bike in a place all by himself in a silent landscape, he might have had insights. But this is but then later, in 1922, he gave a talk at Kyoto University. And during that talk, he said, well, what really happened is, I was sitting in a chair in a patent office in Berlin, when all of a sudden, a thought occurred to me, that when a person falls free, he will not feel his own weight. And he says, I was stunned. This simple thought impressed me greatly. It led me to the theory of gravity. And this, he says, this was the happiest thought in my life. But look at this. Look how odd. He was waiting in an office to get an interview with a bureaucrat. He was bored to death, probably, sitting in his chair. And an insight came. My point will be, insights often come like that. In moments when you're doing nothing at all. Now, quickly, we're going to have to just go quickly over, you know, so that we can say there are three kinds of insights. Problem-solving insights, cause and effect insights, and meaning insights. I'm interested in meaning insights, not in the other two, because we easily confuse. That's the problem-solving insight, you know that, right? That's Archimedes. The cause and effect insight, that's Newton, you know that too. You know the apple? And how Newton discovered the causal nexus, the causal connection between gravity, right? And then this. These are meaning insights. This is what I mean. This is what phenomenology is interested in, not any other two. And I'm quoting here the poet, Rilke. And the picture is a picture of the panther. Because Rilke, at one point, he was unable to write any more poetry. And at that point, he was working for Rodin, the famous sculptor in Paris. And he said to Rodin, man, I haven't been able to write. And you just, every day I see you working on these nice sculptures and it's beautiful. How do you do it? Rodin said, go to the Jardin des Plantes, which is the zoo. Go and sit in front of those cages. A couple of weeks will be good. Sit just in front of one of those cages for a couple of weeks and you will see. And then write what you see. What it is that you see. Well, that first poem that will be made is called The Panther. It's a very famous poem. And it is the first of the seeing poems that will be. The seeing poems. That's seeing. Now, look at this. This is just a beautiful little quote. If I were to tell you where my greatest feeling, my universal feeling, the bliss of my earthly existence has been, I would have to confess it has always been here and there, being in this kind of in-seeing. What a wonderful word, in-seeing. In the indescribably sift, deep, timeless moment of this divine seeing into the heart of things. That's phenomenology. Okay? It's a beautiful sort of quote. He doesn't mention Kairos, but it's really a Kairos quote, that quote. And now Inception, again, very good. Inception is a Heidegger notion. And I spent quite a bit of time because Inception is kind of a new notion that comes up in books that have been recently published and translated, only in the last 4 or 5 years. And many philosophers haven't even really dealt with this literature. But in these texts, I didn't use the notion of inception. A lot can be said about it. But inception is really that sort of, just look at the quotes in order to. He says, inceptuality unfolds the beginning, because this has to do with how we get to meaning, how we come to an understanding of the meaning of something, of the lived moment. And he says, appropriate the beginning of meanings, whose essence we are starting to summarize. What a wonderful. Well, I mean, I think it's sometimes very inceptual speech, he says, is always indebted to the beginning for the eventuation of the thoughtful word. Right? You see why the whole topic of inception is so fascinating. He says, inception is the sudden insight into that which is the journey. And he sort of says, you know, inception is the grasping of something. But you shouldn't really think about the something, but rather what you should see is that the grasping itself is that meaning that you're trying to get at. It's the turning of the term. That's it. It's a bit confusing, but that's the point. Those are the books that he writes about. Yeah? The left two are translations of the same book, but the people weren't happy with the first translation, so they did the whole thing all over them. Look at this. Just amazing. Now, and then there's the notion of insight and concept. Because concept is the opposite of insight. Concept has boundaries. But insight is the poetic. Insight, you might say, is the ingrasping of meaning. The translation to German would be ingrasping. It's the ingrasping is a knowing awareness, which is not a proposition known. These are just a little quotes from Heidegger. So here, the distinction between concept and insight, begriff and inbegriff. You see? And Heidegger says, the significance of conceptuality lies in the grasping of the journey itself. It's the radical turn. But in a moment, you know, already I indicated this, if you notice, you know, it's this moment when Marion maybe was like, you know, when you turn your face, you think, maybe that turning of the head. And I'm saying it because of this quote by Roland Barthes, who you may know. He's a wonderful French author, for that now, from the book Jouissance. And he says, just, it's humorous, almost humorous, but at the same time, it's really interesting. He said, to be with the one I love and to think of something else, my wife would say, what? This is how I have my best ideas. It's the insight. And he says, it can be an act that is slight, complex, tenuous, almost scatterbrained. And then look at this, a sudden movement of the head, like a bird, who understands nothing of what we hear, who hears what we do not understand. It's that moment where you go, huh? Right? That. I think it's just a wonderful way to capture it. You know, these are things that Julia said, it occurred to me, it crossed my mind, it came to me, I seem to stumble upon. Have you not seen things like that? Yeah. And then you wonder where. And this is Heidegger, and I really wonder about the idea of insight. How did Heidegger, at this inceptual moment of insight, right? And Heidegger famously loved to walk. And I think when you walk, you may have insight. And here's the desk. And then here, I have to be careful now. Right? He loved to walk in the woods. And he's looking over. And that's how I wonder, did he have these insights when he was having coffee? When he was after supper?
Staring into nothingness, right? When did these insights come? Because he has so many of them. So amazing.
And then my students, you have written papers like this. All these papers that were in my class, in the phenomenology seminar, all of these have become dissertations, doctoral dissertations. Really, many of them are wonderful dissertations. Many of these students are now professors themselves, of course. Oh, gee, I'd like to read that, but I don't think I can. But this is a student, because I'm asking students, tell me about the moment when you got an insight. That when you were writing something and it happened. How was that? This is just a wonderful portrayal of a moment like that, when she was at a concert, and while listening to the music, she realized what she was not doing right. She just amazing. So, now, so I'm asking, how, you know, what conditions these insights that they may come? And that's, I've written a bit about this, and sort of what you may say is, well, it is a kind of an active passivity, right? That happens, that makes it possible. Or a sort of evanescence, you have to read for yourself, the fleeting moment. Or the serendipitous, that's how it comes. You know, almost like through the back door, you can't control it. It's like a gift of grace. You cannot find it, it finds you. And it's like that. There's a sense of contingency about it. And also that you have to be touched by it. So these are, I think, are sort of like the dispositions that may, you know, be part of our own sort of sense of preparedness when this happens. And now, the turning. I'm using these terms, you know, maybe sorry if I'm being a bit ridiculous, but because these are sort of movement terms, right? And I think it's something really interesting and important about the idea of turning. And what I'd like to show you is the idea of Orpheus as gifts. And do you remember the story of Orpheus and Eurydice? And you call that an evanescent, in a moment I'll show you, okay? An evanescent moment of the sexual luminosity. You see something. Right? An evanescent moment of the sexual luminosity. I think that's one of these moments, you know, sort of a way of trying to get it. Now, you see, Orpheus had married Eurydice, but shortly after, she stepped on a snake, who bit her, and she died. And then, of course, as people go to the underworld, Orpheus was so totally devastated by it, and he could not help but play his harp, sort of
a liar,
and just pleading with the god, please give her back, please bring her back, let me take her back to the world, please, you know, I cannot do without her. And the gods were so sort of moved by his song. They're so powerful, the enchantments, that they say, okay, you can do that, you can bring it back. On one condition, don't turn, don't look back. Because if you look back before you have reached the world, the outside world, if you look back before, she will be taken away from you and never see her again. So, here is Desmond Rice, and Orpheus tries to hear Eurydice. He steps behind him. He's walking. And he listens. Is she there? But he can't hear anything. And he starts to believe that the gods have fooled him. And of course, Eurydice was behind him, but as a shadow. She was still a shadow, waiting to come to light and flesh, to become a full human being, a full woman again. Only a few steps away from the exit, Orpheus lost his faith and turns to see. Eurydice went behind him, but her shadow is visible.
Another chance. That's the myth of Orpheus and Eurydice, right?
And as it happened, Orpheus reached his hand. You know, he saw her, and he didn't see her. Because in that moment of almost seeing her and almost touching her, people have painted these moments. It's just quite remarkable, you know, but in vain. Right? Now, I was fascinated about this story, and some of the Norse have done that with some myths. And this one has been discussed also with Marion in a different context. And Blanchot says about this, Orpheus didn't make a mistake at all. What? Orpheus wanted to see her in her mortality, in her perfection. He didn't want to see the ordinary woman. Yes, she was beautiful, yes, she was perfect, yes, all that. But he wanted to see the love itself. He wanted to see her in her perfection. He wanted to see Eurydice in her nocturnal darkness. in a distance, a body closed, a face sealed, which wants to see her not when she is visible, but when she is invisible. And not as the intimacy of the familiar, but as the strange which excludes all intimacy.
He doesn't want to make her live, right? This is the artist, who is ultimately more interested in truth than in human relation. And Blanchot, this philosopher, he is a fascinating philosopher, Maurice Blanchot, he says, all artists, all true artists are like that. All true artists, whether they act, whether they the dance, the expressiveness, whether they paint or write, all artists are in that sense writers. You know, they want to see, but they shouldn't be seeing. And that's it. Now, what I want to do is read from you some passages. This is really, for me, this is really important. In fact, you know, I find this. Okay. Yeah. The Five Senses by Sarah. This book by Sarah. It's so amazing. It's so what I'm going to read you is really the story of Orpheus and Eurydice. And Sarah, this philosopher, he writes it, he rewrites it in a phenomenological manner. And he shows how Orpheus is creating flesh out of words, but ultimately fails. Right? And this is so touching that this is, again, the idea of inseeing of reality, right? And how insights can come about through language. So this is what I'd like to do. And then as I do this, you will see some images that help, I think, with it. Sometimes I get so overcome because it's such an incredible text. And then he says, Orpheus is singing, brings, you know, I really think that Del Close, he would have loved this. He would have just absolutely loved it. Because this is the power of your language. This is the power of language, of song, of word, of dance. Orpheus is the dancer. He is the god of movement, of dance. Orpheus is singing, brings Eurydice back to incarnated flesh. She leaves the word, the word, she leaves the word, arises from her name, frees herself from the cartouche, removes herself from representation. You can read along with me, right? Rediscovers movement, solidity, her dissolved flesh and vanished radiance, the material volume of her body, the delicate, sandy texture of her skin, the variable, clear-colored light of her gaze. The horizontal agility of her gait as it adapts to the ground, the weight of her chest, hips, shoulders, and neck, her heart skeleton. She steps softly out of shadow, image and word. The word is made flesh. Evocation, something flesh emerges from voice. Orpheus invokes, his voice and strings tremble. He calls out, shouts, sings, chants. He composes both music and Eurydice. The ghost woman reawakens. She follows her vocation. Voice makes the name flesh, delivers words from death. Life dispels the darkness. Music adds flesh, hardens but is soft. How far does the incarnation go? Just as the hard beasts of the underworld trail softly behind the lyre's harmony, just as the dark forest softens the sharp thorns and needles in concert. The soft evocation, Eurydice follows her husband into the propylene, which it is forbidden to cross in this way. Eurydice hardens. She becomes a woman again. As the lion guarding the underworld advances, it becomes image. It becomes image, shadow, phantom. It is more verbal than normal. Eurydice's progress, on the other hand, becomes flesh and blood. Her name finds voice. The voice finds harmony. Harmony of throat, a throat of head. Head and flowing hair emerge from her shoulders. She springs forth from evocation, torso, armpits, waist and breasts rising out of darkness, light and warm, softened skin wrinkled in frozen darkness. Orpheus composes, constructs a living Eurydice, piece by piece, sense by sense, stand up and walk, go, speak. Evocations,
something fresh emerges from voice. Our V is in focus. His voice and streams tremble. He calls out, shouts. The length of the labyrinth shows how much patience is required to achieve incarnation. Creation emerges from the underworld, where words, concepts, images, names, and shadows flit about. It incorporates them through enchantment or by summoning them, frigid, rugged, phenomenal awakens. Orpheus sets himself the most difficult of tasks. But of course we know already that the word fails, and thus Michel Serra continues. Orpheus fails in his attempt to drag Eurydice to the very top of the incline. In the very last act of making flesh, his lover collapses back into her own shadow, head into throat, and throat into harmony, and harmony into voice, and voice into name, instantaneous involution, reversion to epithet. I think these sentences are really, really important for philosophical too. The supreme achievement, rare and grandiose, is giving life to speech. See, this is Heidegger always is complaining about that, but we do is conceptualize things. We kill things when we write, instead of keeping them alive in the living moment. The banal, everyday gesture, the easy one, is to substitute word for a thing. Creation tries to break through to the world itself, to the world that lived. But nothing is quite as easy, so most of the time, as conceptualizing. So Serra is really criticizing method, theory, conceptualization. And he wants to show how the lyrical and sonorous qualities of language can bring about understandings that ordinary propositional discourses cannot. This painting I chose for the cover of my book, because that's really what the book is about. You know, what Fermi launch is about. Is the turn, the looking back and trying to see what in some sense cannot really be seen, but you have to try. You know, that's the wonderful project of phenomenology. Okay, now, I have just a couple of minutes left. Just the right, 7 minutes.
Okay.
Just right. Good. Now, you've probably seen the series Wallander, the Swedish one or the British one, and here's, you know, Kenneth Ranoff. And you know how he, well, his wife left him. He is just always so bloody. It's like he's always ill. He's so depressed. He's such a difficult person to live with, right? And yet he is an incredible inspector. But often he doesn't know how to solve his problems. He cannot see it. And so, you know, he gets more ill. And he goes home and sits in a chair. And he drags him away back home. And you see, you think, oh, this is not going well. It's boring at all, you know. But then what happens? He sits in his chair at home, and you see him sit in the TV series, and he acts so well, you know, kind of problem. And then you see him. He goes, like that. Right? And you say, huh? That's the term. And you know he found something. He thought of something. He had an insight. And then this, that never is a person more active than I'm doing nothing. And so, it's, what does doing nothing mean? Well, for me, it often is, you know, when I sit on my rower, at home I have a rower, you know, and I turn the music up really loud, and for about half an hour I sit on the rower, and you know, when I just do this, and listen to the music, that's when I suddenly go, I have a thought. And I always have a pad with me to write it down. That's where my insights come from. You know, some of the insights, you know, that whole series of you know, serendipity and so on, I've got on my road. It's when you go for a walk, when you go for a bicycle, but not like Einstein, sort of freshly, but you know, really. Then this may happen. And
so here, you know, the idea of peripatetic
thinking is walking with thinking. Socrates did that. Heidegger loved to walk. I think when he was walking, he had his insights. Sartre didn't walk. He's like a pale gas. That's where he got his insights. Except this. I was doing a presentation in drive it out into the area, and suffer, have been there.
And in this walking, this is suffering.
I find it striking image. And I wonder if he had insights in that moment. And then this, oh my gosh. This is kind of interesting.
Correlated vision methods,
phenomenology, mostly, for me. And the other one was pedagogy. I was teaching courses in pedagogy. But I see these very closely related, even though I haven't said anything about pedagogy now. Nevertheless, by the way, those are phenomenologists that are really fascinating. Maybe I can get back to those people. The one on the left. My sense is that if you do phenomenological work on, let's say, you know, a notion like that you never see anything about in teaching texts, you know, about recognition. My sense is that almost every child wants to be recognized. And I don't mean the cheap sort of phrase, but the deep sense of recognition. You know, you want that. I know with my own kids, and I'm sometimes so touched. You know, I don't know what to do with it, but Michael or Mark, I see in them, they want my approval. They want recognition. Recognition is a fundamental idea from Hegel. So what I'm saying is that if you phenomenologically understand these human experiences, then that becomes your pedagogy. You know, if you understand the experience of pirates, then that becomes your pedagogy. And you see, the subtitle of the book Pedagogy for that is knowing what to do. It says there, but you can read it. Knowing what to do when you don't know what to do. Because, you see, it's not a method, but it is something that has to do with you. But you have to internalize what it means to work with recognition, understand difficulty in the child experience. Like all teachers use the word difficulty a lot. There are so many kinds of difficulties. Some difficulties have good difficulties, aren't they? Others are negative, and so on. As a teacher, you understand the phenomenology of difficulty. Then, that becomes part of your pedagogical practice. So for me, phenomenology builds your thoughtfulness, and pedagogy in action is your tact. You turn your thoughtfulness into tact. Tact is always something you do, right? But often, in a moment, you don't know what to do, and yet you have to act. And if you have done enough phenomenology, in some sense, because we all do it all, we don't have to take phenomenology courses, but if you have thought, reflected on things, then that, I think, contributes to your sense of being a teacher, you know, and your sense of thoughtfulness, and that becomes tactfulness. Right? Does that help a bit, or?
Thank you. Okay. While the microphone's going to the next person, I just thought, actually we had a beautiful example of it this morning,
yeah.
Watching Ruth, because she engaged with each child, she looked at them, and then she remembered that the early children had not done the new different thing and might feel left out. So she went round again to give them a chance. I mean, I'm just hoping while we were listening to you that people would remember what we saw this morning. The time that she took to allow both herself to act and the children.
I think phenomenology helps us understand the meaningfulness, the meaning of our existence. And pedagogy is how you act it out as a teacher. Pedagogy is also for parents, right? And with pedagogy, I don't mean instruction. Mm-hmm. Pedagogy is the relationality, is knowing what to do. Pedagogy always is the ethics of teaching. It's the ethics. Being able to distinguish what is good for a child and what is not so good. You know, that is almost the definition of pedagogy. Distinguishing actively what is appropriate, what is good for a child, and what is not good for a child. As a parent, you do it all day long. You know, and often afterwards you think to yourself, oh, bloody hell, what did I do? What did I say? Why did I say that? Right? In the pedagogy book, I start out on the first chapter with a story that someone told me, we were sitting around some friends, and it's all about. He's not really my friend, but anyway, I know him because for other friends, he's in his 80s. And he was telling a story. And he said, you know, when I was very young, I was playing the violin. Because we were talking about the concert that was given in Victoria, Canada, you know, and how difficult it is to be a concertmaster, you know, in an orchestra. And then he says, you know, so I was playing the violin, but I knew that wasn't for me. I couldn't do it. I never could have. So I said to my father, I want to stop.
you know, this is like, I will never achieve anything. And my father didn't want to stop. He said, you have to do it. You have to, oh, you've got this beautiful instrument, you have to do it. Right? I don't know what people do here. You risk it anyway. That's the problem, isn't it? So often is that the case of music education. And he said, when I insisted, my father took the violin out of my hands and he said, I'm going to hang it on the wall. So from now on, when you look at the violin on the wall, you'll know what a failure you are in my eyes. And then his friend said, it hanged there for several weeks. But then my mother took it away because she felt bad. But he said, what she could not take away was the empty spot. It was always there. And he said, all my life, my father has never, ever apologized. Never, ever made right. And he says, you know, I couldn't have told this story. Only now, I'm 86, I can tell you the story without breaking down. Isn't that astonishing? You know, how something happens in your childhood, and all your life, it's got a logical consequence. That's pedagogy. That is the pedagogy of life.
Thank you so much. I relate to something you said earlier when we talk the importance of dance and how meaningful dance can be in the phenomenological study method. I quoted Ken Robinson in my paper when he says we can think in movement rather than think about movement. Do you believe that a young child, before they're textually and language equipped to construct the idea, can they think through their body, and can that then become a meaningful moment in those recollections, those memories that you mentioned right back at the start of the talk?
Well, you know, I mean, this may be disappointing, but my sense really is that we cannot reflect in the moment. You can reflect on it afterwards, you can reflect about things that happened in the past, you can reflect what happened just now. But in the moment when you reflect, it's like reflecting on your anger. When you try to catch your anger, it's gone. And that's also, you know, so this is the really important point, because in education you have Donald Sherman, you know, the reflective practitioner. I honestly think that has done a lot of harm to teaching education. Professors which tell those students, when you teach, you have to think while you teach. Nonsense. No one can do that. That's ridiculous. You can think afterwards, right? But in a moment you can be thoughtful. I'm not saying you cannot be thoughtful, but you cannot go like, okay, what shall I do now? Well, I can do this, 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 or this. If I do this, then I do that one. If I do that, that thing. But if I do this, I wonder what the consequences. Maybe I should do this. It doesn't work like that, right? You cannot teach like that, you cannot be a parent like that. In the moment.
Sometimes you have to think before.
Of course. And sometimes you have to count to 10 or 20 or whatever, right?
And teaching, you do that too.
Yeah. So, you know, it's not like that. And doesn't it also sometimes happen that you say something, you do something, and you say, oh, wait, you know, I didn't mean that. Right? And you go like that. But it's true. But when you teach a class of 30 kids, you can usually not count to 10. You have to act. Right?
There's somebody at the back.
Thank you very much. I have a question about the example of the wine bottle.
Okay.
Let's say in that room there are two wine bottles, one on one side of the room and one on another side of the room. Presumably, you would have had the experience of loneliness if you looked at either bottle.
No. Depends on which bottle was meant to be.
Well, okay, let's say that they were going to drink both of them. Oh, okay, right. In that case, if it's because it was that bottle that was the one that was meant to be, that suggests to me that there's going to be some process of understanding that it was indeed that bottle. Before knowing that it was to make him feel lonely, suggesting that there is some deviation, it seems to me.
Yeah, and Vandenberg would not say that you don't see the bottle, that you don't see the white label, that you
you see that too, but really, you know, in a sense, you overlook that. It's a bit like Sartre, when Sartre talks about, you know, when I talk about the three types of movements, and Sartre says, much of the time, we don't notice our body. Even you guys, you know, who are always involved in body and movement and that and whatever. Sartre says, much of the time, your body is experienced by sensuous events, bashed over in silence. It's only the suffering you can explain, you think, what's going on, right? And now you feel your body. Or when someone bounces against you, or when someone looks at you, and you think, what the hell are they looking at? Or whatever, right? Then, but most of the time, even when you're sitting where you're sitting, unless you're getting really tired, you know, you don't notice your body. Your body, in the first dimension of Sattva, is perceptual signals, passed over in silence. You don't notice. And I think it's that sort of thing that Vandenberg was talking about with the wine bottles. You don't really see the bottle as an object. When you look at the bottle, you think, oh, God, too bad it didn't come.
If I may, it's a question about immediacy. And
yeah,
if we
immediacy.
And then if we would agree that there are processes that perceive the meaning, even if they're not conscious phenomenologically, what do we make of those processes? I'm thinking
well, you know, I don't think it helps to say unconsciously, you know, unconsciously, that would be a problem, right? So, but I can see though, that, you know, I thought it's just now, you take out a bottle, and you think something's going to come, and then not show up. So there's the bottle, still full, I didn't open it. So what now do you do? And you think, oh well, shall I drink tonight anyway? Or shall I put it back to the other bottle? So you look at the bottle and you think, yeah, it's too expensive, this one I should put back there. Maybe you get a cheaper one out of it. You know, so yeah, of course. But when Vandenberg is reading his book, and after, you know, 50 minutes, half an hour, he looked up and saw that bottle. That's what he is asking. What did he see in the moment? If you say, you saw a green bottle with the right label, he would say, yeah, yeah, in some sense, but that's not really what I saw. I saw my disappointment.
Thanks.
Yeah. There any more? Yes, another one at the back.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Does what you've presented suggest particular types of research methods in terms of interviews or observations, or is the most important part the quality of the insight?
Yeah. But you know, the insights don't usually come about in the interview, right? So if you, you know, my sense is, as a phenomenologist, when you interview, all you want to get is experiential descriptions from people. So you ask, what was the plan for you when this happened? And you hope that people will not explain anything, but then they actually will say, well, you know, it was like this. And then they tell you how they actually experienced that moment, that little moment, right? And then you, as your task, as a phenomenologist, to look at that and say, okay, so what's going on? What is the dimension of meaning? You know, the fancy word, what is the essence here of this moment? Right? So that doesn't happen in the interview. Yeah, a lot of all that research is interview, but really, from my point of view, you know, a lot of it is very superficial. Right? You know, most of the interview is very difficult. And I do, you know, with my students, we work on this, and they go out and do the interview, they come back, and man, what a mess. So it really takes time to learn, to get that experiential stuff. You think that's the most, the easiest of all, the experience. It's the most difficult thing of all. Because most people, when you interview them, they'll give you their opinions, they give you their views, they give you their, you know, whatever they think about it. Right? That's what they give you, but not the experiential detail. That's hard to
get.
That's actually, as teachers, what we need to know. What we need to get some insight into the experience of our students.
Yeah.
That's what teaching, that's it is what it is. So how do we gain insight into their experience? That would be another very long discussion.
So it's one thing to get an insight into the inner life of a student, and if you don't understand the inner life of your students, how can you? same time, understanding that what the student experiences is one thing, to actually make sense of it, you know, phenomenologically, to understand it in, at a level, that's still something else.
Yeah.
You know?
I think when we teach arithmetic, we're playing, we as teachers improvise for the class, but we also put ourselves in an open position, and you experiment with your improvisation to see how they respond. In this way, you begin to understand what they can show you, not necessarily just what they know, but what they can show you.
Raymond and I were talking about it the other day. The whole idea of improvisation is really important, right? And I think I have a sense from the way I'm seeing what you guys are doing that we have different kinds of improvisation. But the improvisation that I'm inclined myself to think of has to do with the word improvisation, to improve. What are you improving? You may improvise. And jazz artists, they will say, well, it's this melody, it's this thing that they learn on it, and they take turns improving it, making it interesting. And when I look at my favorite jazz artists, you know, with Ron Carter or Bobby Timmons, and there are some portions, you know, of the performances that I just love. I can play it over and over. It was an improvisation. Now, of course, it's recorded. And I hear the same thing over and over, but it was in the moment of improvising, it was a true improvisation. Not just the chaotic jumping up and down, but improvisation. Improved.
I think we haven't stopped. Thank you very much.